Okay, hit record. Here we go. Hi, everybody.
Welcome to class.
Yeah, sure. If you have one and you like taking notes on computers, go for it. If you only like have a phone or something, then we could even use phones later. One thing I will do is do one of those breakout room sessions again, where it's we can kind of all talk to each other. So until that point, you can do whatever you want, but I encourage you to join the Zoom room if you'd like to. Yeah, so it's Thursday. We had a virtual class Monday, which actually I felt went pretty well. We're dealing with some pretty challenging material. I think I already told you this is some of the hardest stuff we will do all semester. We're starting on a hard note, so to speak. And one reason for that is it sets us up, right? It kind of gives us like a theory of religion. That, I don't know if you could tell, but that's basically what we're doing is trying to think, what is religion? How do you study it? And so you can even take what we're talking about last class and today with you into your other religion classes, because you will have to take other religion classes, or you know, your life, or you know, wherever you encounter religion. So it's challenging, but the goal is to kind of come up with a sense of what is religion, how do you study it? And so that's why we're focusing so much on this scripture stuff. Here is the assignment for tonight. It's very short, I think, what did I say, two paragraphs, right? So it's not like you have to write some marathon of an essay or anything like that. The main thing is I want you to think about what we talk about in class, right? So what I've asked you to do is to choose a love song. It could be any love song, but it should be a love song, not just any song, but a love song, and interpret it as a scripture. So there are kind of two parts to that, right? First, we just need to understand the love song on its own. That's something we'll talk about in class today. And then the second part is we'll need to think about, we'll need to think about interpreting it as scripture and how that changes the song. Okay. So, and then what are the consequences of that? So this might sound a little bit confusing right now. We're going to walk through it together. That's basically what we're going to do most of the day today. And then if there is time, actually, I just taught another section. We'll get to Tevye the Dairyman. So this is a story by Shalom Alechaim, who grew up in Eastern Europe, came to New York, wrote about, he is basically the basis of Fiddler on the Roof. Have you guys ever seen Fiddler on the Roof? That's a very famous movie. So if you don't know it, here, I'll put it in the chat. Fiddler on the Roof. Yeah, if you don't know it, you will know it later. But before that, we'll go over this forum post and kind of what I'm asking you to do here. Any questions off the bat about what I'm asking you to do? Okay. And another thing is, I want you to cite Smith. So I guess before we get into it, why am I giving you this assignment? Well, one reason is I want to give you a chance to just think about what we've been discussing so far. I want to see kind of what your writing looks like, because we all come from, you know, different schools, different background. I think this is the first year for a lot of us, if not everybody. And so, you know, we all have different training when it comes to writing. And so it's almost like I get to see where you're at, and then I'm going to work with you, right? I'm going to give you feedback. For the forum post, it won't be really individualized feedback, but I will give you general feedback, general instructions. And honestly, the best way to learn how to write is to just do it a lot and edit it, right? Editing is so important. I'll even write in the chat, the best way to learn how to write is edit. A lot of the time when I was in college, I was a science major, so I wasn't a great writer. And whenever I had to write, I just did it. You know, it's almost like you kind of hold your breath and you eat something that tastes nasty, like medicine or something like that. It's just like, all right, I'm going to hold my breath and just type this thing out and just get it done with it, and then push it away, turn it in. I never have to look at it again. Is that a familiar scenario? You guys ever done that before? Maybe you guys are much more mature writers than I was. But the real way to be a good writer is to edit. It's always going to be crappy. Maybe not always, but most of the time it's going to be kind of crappy on the first draft. And so this is the most difficult hump to get over, right? Is you just put something out there, but then you got something to work with, right? Then you come back to it and you make it better. You come back to it, make it better and better and better and better. So this is something, again, I'm here to help you learn how to do, right? Is to learn how to write. And one part of writing, why don't I even open up this prompt here, is you can see these instructions here, kind of what am I going to grade on, the point system and everything. I want you to make an argument, right? Which is basically just explain how your song changes when you interpret it as a scripture. It should be organized. It should be sort of clear communication. And one big thing is I want you to cite Smith, what is scripture, right? And again, we're going to go over him in a moment. So how do you cite him? Yeah, so Jen is asking about formatting. Because I already know it's Smith, this is how I want you to do it. It's just like I do it in the slides. You have quote, 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 and then you do Smith, and then page 18. And then done. So I already know who Smith is. I already know what the book is. You don't have to explain it to me, right? You don't need a bibliography. All I want to know is what the page number is. So do include the page number. Do include the page number. And it's a classic, just do what I do, right? Just do what I do on the slides, right? Tell me the page number. And then if I don't know what you're talking about, or if you interpret it in one way and I think, huh, that's an interesting interpretation. What else is going on in that paragraph? Then I can open up the book and I can find it, right? That's the whole point. It's to kind of leave a trail that I can look, I can follow up on. These slides are for you, right? I mean, I make these slides. It's basically like my digest of what is most important from the reading. So you can use these when you're writing. In fact, I would encourage you to. If you're looking for, you know, what is Smith all about? I would say he's about all these things, right? And so when we think about this idea of what is scripture, again, we covered this on Monday. It was a remote class. So it was a little hard to kind of get into it. Now we're here in this room together. We can follow up. Smith has this line that scripture is a human activity. He writes it in italics even. And so it must be very important for him. And because I didn't write the page number, it means it's on the same page as this one. So these are all part of the same paragraph, page 18. I guess, first of all, what does that mean? So I've got a prop today. We're not actually going to read from this, but this is a book of Buddhist scriptures. What does Smith mean when he says scripture is a human activity? Please. Yeah, I like that idea. Yeah, it's almost like, have you ever heard that, I guess it's a riddle, if a tree falls in the forest and no one's around to hear it, does it make a sound? You ever heard that before? I remember I heard that when I was a kid. I was like, yeah, of course it does. But what's your name?
Leo.
Leo? Okay, so just like Leo's talking about, does a book mean anything if no one's there to read it, right? Usually we might think there's some sort of meaning like just in these pages, right? But if you think about it, this is just, you know, dead tree pulp that's been processed and turned into a page with some ink slapped on it. You turn it upside down, you turn it sideways, it doesn't really mean anything. But like Leo's saying, the minute we kind of set our eyes on it, activate our imaginations, activate our life and our experiences, and we bring them to the page, then all of a sudden, meaning gets created, right? And so without the human part, scripture can't really do what it's supposed to do, can it? Great. Yeah, very good. Other thoughts on this? So moving forward, there's also this notion that it implies a relationship. What is the relationship? Smith sort of danced around this, but I put it very clearly here in my own words. We've got three things, right? We've got the human, right? That's us, just like Leo was talking about. We've got the transcendent. That could be God, very simply put, right? For a Christian person, that would be God. For a Buddhist person, that would be maybe enlightenment or perhaps even just the Buddha. For a Hindu person, that could be Brahma, it could be Vishnu, it could be whoever, right? Something transcendent, something sacred, something beyond our usual everyday lives. Have you heard this word transcendent before? It's being used in kind of a weird way. What does transcendent mean to you guys? Does that mean anything to you? Transcendent? It's like a being? Sorry, I can't hear you. Theme, oh, okay. It's like a theme. Can you say more? How is it like a theme? Oh, okay. I'm trying to think if that is in line with my understanding, but I'm not sure. Maybe. Let's put that in the maybe pile. A theme, and you said it's like a summary of the book? Like an... Okay, something you learn from a book. Okay. Transcendence. Well, in this case, that's exactly what it's saying, right? Again, if we come back to Leo's point, right? We've got the book, we've got the scripture. I would argue not every book connects us with this transcendent thing, right? But what's happening here is we have us, we have a book, and then we have God. And how do we connect with God? How do we relate to God? Is through this scripture, right? Usually we just sort of live our everyday lives. Would you say you guys are having a pretty normal everyday life today? No? Did you have a very special day today, Kevin? Coming to class is special. It's true. Today it's our first week. We've only done this once before, so it is sort of a special day. Eventually, this will feel very normal, though, right? We'll see each other again and again and again. But I don't mean to say today is necessarily the same for everybody, right? Because some people, maybe something special happened. Maybe you slipped on the ice outside. I almost slipped on the ice today. That would have made it for an interesting day if I had actually fallen down, right? So some days are more exciting than others, but let's just assume it's a normal day today. The transcendent, God, the sacred, all that sort of stuff will be kind of outside of our normal life, right? It's in some special place. It's in a church somewhere. And it's, you know, it's special time, special place, special circumstance. But by reading a book like this, right, we can kind of bring this transcendent element into our lives. And so when we think about scripture, what is it doing? It's managing this relationship between humans and the transcendent. What is in between is the text, right, is the scripture. So that's basically the takeaway from Smith that I want you guys to get. We've got this relationship between people and the universe in light of their perception of a given text. That's the language that he uses. So those three things, right, us, God, scripture is in between, kind of allowing us to connect to God. Does that make sense? You guys have any questions about that? So as we go back to this forum post, what am I asking you to do is think about that process where it's you've got us, you've got God, and thinking about our relationship, except in between, rather than a story, rather than a myth or a narrative of some kind, it's a love song. Does that make sense? So there's a good example of this, which is the Song of Songs. And again, we looked at this very quickly last time. We actually didn't have time to read through it very carefully, so we can do that together today. This is from the Old Testament. I didn't assign it for homework or anything. We didn't read it together. I guess, first of all, have you heard of this before, the Song of Songs? It's also known as the Song of Solomon. It's pretty famous, Old Testament. It's the Bible, right? People have been talking about this for a long time. But it's a weird phenomenon. I don't know exactly how it happened. Maybe some scholar somewhere does know. But it's a love song. Here we have a love song. People would like sing this in taverns. This would be kind of a popular, it'd be like on the equivalent of the radio, whatever, 3,000 years ago, maybe 2,500 years ago. And it begins with this line, "Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is more delightful than wine. Pleasing is the fragrance of your perfumes. Your name is like perfume poured out. No wonder the young women love you," right? Does that sound like the Bible to you? Not really, right? It's kind of weird. Kiss me with the kisses of your mouth? It's totally romantic. Yeah, it's a little bit weird language, right? It's a little poetic, but yeah, it's basically just saying, hey, baby, give me a kiss. I love loving you. It's so delightful. It's like I'm drunk. You know, you smell great and everybody loves you. All the beautiful women love you, right? Take me away with you. Let us hurry, blah, blah. And so it's a woman singing to a man, saying how much she loves him. The friends respond. And then again, eventually the man shows up. He says that she's beautiful. He compares her to horses, like kind of a beautiful, powerful horse, a mare among chariots, horses. Your cheeks are beautiful with earrings, your neck with strings of jewels. We will make you earrings of gold studded with silver. It's just, they're just like saying how much they love each other, right? They're just totally admiring each other. And again, this is the passage we read last time. We get this feeling of love is blazing like a fire that waters cannot put out. This is a, dare I say, erotic passage, right? This is about love. This is about attraction, being attracted to each other. What do you think this is doing in the Bible? This is a scripture, right? Somebody put this in the Bible. This made it into the canon. Actually, this is a word we haven't talked about, but it's a good word, is canon.
Put it up here too.
What's a canon? It's only one N, right?
It's like the
the books that actually count. Yeah, exactly. Your name's Anthony?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. Okay. So yeah, the books that actually count. I like the way you put that because sometimes this is applied to like modern stories too. Like Star Wars or something, right? So is the Mandalorian considered part of the canon? You guys watching Mandalorian? Actually, I tried to watch the first episode and then I got distracted and I didn't make it through. So maybe I'll give it another try eventually. And I guess it probably is, right? Is that, I guess, is it? Do you guys know? Is it part of the canon, Mandalorian? Not really, right? But maybe it is. It's Disney. It's kind of like a big deal. It's not like fan fiction or something. Like if somebody just wrote a random story on the internet, that would not be a part of the canon, right? The movies are the real canon. And it's sort of an expanding one. We could say it's an open canon, maybe. Here are some Buddhist scriptures. This is by no means the entire canon. This is just like a selection. In fact, Buddhism is kind of unique in the sense that, maybe unique's not the word, but it's extreme in the sense that the canon is so open and there's so many languages. If we got all the Buddhist scriptures, it would like fill up this entire room. It'd be outrageous because there's Sanskrit, there's Tibetan, there's Chinese, there's Pali. There are various vernacular languages too. And so all of these have these giant collections of hundreds of scriptures that don't really have clear endings or beginnings. It's really kind of outrageous. So what is a canon for Buddhists? It's pretty open. There's tons of stuff in the canon. This is maybe a hard question, or it's going to sound like a hard question. It's actually a pretty easy answer. What is the canon for Christianity? It's the Bible. Yeah. And so it makes you think, like we always sort of assume, oh yeah, the Bible. It's always been the Bible. The Bible has always been the Bible. Of course, right? But somebody had to decide, right? What gets to be included in the Bible? What gets excluded from the Bible? There were meetings like 1500 years ago where there were questions, do we keep the Old Testament? Do we get rid of the Old Testament, right? And of course they decided to keep the Old Testament, but they could have gotten rid of it, right? They could have just kept the Jesus parts. So as a result, there are sort of these two main categories, and then we just call it the Bible. Things that are left out are called apocrypha. That's sort of a fancy religious studies word. It comes from a Greek term, so apocrypha, and that's basically just the opposite, right? It's something that is outside of the canon. It can also be used to talk about something that's sort of an untrue story, right? If there's like a story about a famous person, we could say it's apocryphal, which means it probably didn't actually happen. There are Christian apocrypha. Have you heard of like the Dead Sea Scrolls? Is that a familiar term? Chat, you guys are quiet today. Dead Sea Scrolls, anybody? Okay, yeah, Frank knows. Gnosticism, there are a lot of Gnostic apocryphal texts. Went to the exhibition in 2013-ish. So Frank knows very well. Okay, sweet. Yeah, so long story short, the Dead Sea, you've probably heard of this, right? It's, I think, the lowest elevation sea. It's very salty. And so these old Christian scriptures were found there. They are not in the Bible, and yet they were composed around the time that the materials in the Bible were composed. And so they are what got left out, right? They're not a part of the canon. They are apocrypha. Kind of interesting stuff. And you can see sides of Jesus, right, that perhaps were consciously, what's the word, subdued in later generations, right? The questions about like the divinity of Jesus, is he a god, is he not a god, how does he relate to God, these sorts of things were being explored at that time. And then those questions were answered, the canon was closed, and the story ends. Maybe that's enough of that. So if we come back to this Song of Songs, somebody decided to put this in the canon, right? Somebody decided to put this in the Old Testament. Again, it's a love song. It shows up in the Old Testament, and people are like, well, what do we do with this? And so what did they do? We've got this story of a woman praising a man, of a man praising a woman. They're singing about their love for each other. How do we turn this into a scripture? How do we interpret this as a scripture, like we got to do for this assignment tonight? What do we think? Didn't we go over this last time? It's a good thing we're going over it again. Okay. So you can change the meaning a little bit? Is that what you're saying? I see. So change the language so it's kind of more flowery and more beautiful. But how is this different from, like, I don't know, like Shakespeare or something? Like there's Romeo and Juliet. There's pretty flowery language there too, similar to this, where people are singing love songs to each other. And yet this is, again, part of the Bible, part of the Holy Scriptures that define our relationship with God, right? So what do we do? Well, different people have come up with different answers. Yeah, we've got the he singing to the she, right? Saying things that are nice and saying how beautiful you are and saying how handsome you are. She says something like, yeah, take me away with you, let us hurry. People early on reinterpret this to say the she is us, specifically the nation of Israel. And the he is who? Who's the he? It's God. Yeah. So this, you might read this and think, oh, this is just a love song between a man and a woman. And these early readers of the Bible would say, no, no, no. This is a song of devotion to God. Now, when you read that, you might think, they're talking about kissing each other. I've never talked about kissing God. And they say, oh, don't. It's a metaphor, guys. Come on. And so it's a way of creatively interpreting this text, is thinking, we are the woman, right? Regardless of whether you're a woman or a man, we play the role of the woman here, and God plays the role of the man. And as a result, there's this type of love that gets described here, right? It's sort of a what we might call patriarchal kind of love, where, you know, the man is taking the woman away and marrying her and taking care of her, and then the woman is devoted to the man, and they live happily ever after, something like that. Maybe we could even keep a running list, because one thing I want to explore today, because this will be part of the assignment, is thinking about the different kinds of love. So we could call this, like, which we call it, like a dependent love, or maybe a devotional love. Let's call it dependent. We could call it like a patriarchal love. We could call it a few different things. Can you guys read that? You can probably read that, right? Then we've got this more Christian sort of love that develops. That's actually a special term. Have you guys heard of agape before? It's a Greek term. I don't think I have it on here. What I wrote is divine love. Divine love. Does this ring a bell with anybody? We have something called Agape Latte, freshman year philosophy. Yeah, Frank remembers a lot of stuff. Good. Agape Latte. Have you guys ever been to that? I guess you're probably all relatively new here, don't know about the various events. I've never been either. I get emails about it, though, so if you're interested in talking about religious studies topics, you can probably join in. So what is this divine love? Maybe you've heard there's a lot of things about love in the Bible, right? So like Paul writes something like, love is patient, love is kind. Have you ever heard this phrase before? It's very famous quote, I think, from the Corinthians. Love is patient, love is kind. 1 Corinthians, love is patient, love is kind. Does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, right? So this is describing a certain kind of love. And the word used here is this very special word, agape, this kind of divine word. Oh, free book, I love it. So that's another type of love. Maybe we could say it's an unconditional love. It's a divine love. What is called divine love? So those are two different kinds of love that get read into the story, right? But there are lots of different kinds of love, aren't there? Maybe I'll just open it up. What are the different kinds of love? Let's make a list. Chat, I need your help. What are the different kinds of love? Please. Yeah, platonic love. Platonic love. So the love felt between two friends, exactly. I feel like this kind of implies another kind of love, doesn't it? If it's not platonic, and what is the other type of love that people might mistake platonic love for? Erotic love? Yeah. Romantic love, erotic love, we can call it a few different things. Did I use the word erotic here? Yeah, we've got erotic love here. Erotic love. Good. So we've already come up with a pretty good list. Chat, is there anything else? Are we leaving anything else out? We could probably come up with more if we really tried. But this is a good list. Now, okay,
Professor.
Yes.
What about love for, like, let's say the love for some food? What kind of love is that?
That's a great one. Yeah, love for food. What would you guys call that? Maybe we could call it. It's a little bit derogatory, but there's a term, hedonism. I'll add it to the chat too. Hedonistic love. Does that ring a bell for anybody? It comes from the enjoyment of the senses, right? Where it's basically like you love to eat, you love to drink. A nicer way to put it is like somebody's like a foodie or something. You guys know any foodies? Yeah, so people who dedicate their life to finding delicious foods. I find foodies are very fun to hang out with. I'm not really a foodie, but I kind of like to hang out with them because then they know where all the good food is at. Hedonism is kind of a negative term. It basically means like your main pursuit is pleasure, right? To find pleasurable things. But I think this is definitely one way that the word love is used, right? It's like, oh, did you like that restaurant? Oh, I loved it, right? It was so good. And so, yeah, that's a great example. What else? There's actually one I just thought of that is very important we're leaving out here. Another love between different types of people. So this dependent love, platonic love, erotic love, a lot of this is talking about romantic partners. But what if somebody, obviously platonic is not romantic, but more of a friend. But what if somebody is your family member? Isn't that another kind of love? You guys ever tell your parents that you love them? Ever call them up and say, Mom, I miss you. I love you. If you haven't done it in a while, you know, she might appreciate it. I'm just saying. All right. So what should we call that? Familial, maybe? I think the love for a parent and the love for like a sibling might even be different, but we don't need to cut this too thinly, right? We can call it familial. How's that sound? Familial love. We got a good list here, guys. Look at this. Now, I was listening to an interview, and I found this quotation from Maya Angelou that really kind of inspired me. Wait, is it coming through the speakers? Is this working? That'd be amazing. It didn't work last time. Let's see if it works. Coming through up there? It sounds kind of crappy though. Let me try something real quick. One sec. Hayden 203-3351. I think that's what I'm supposed to do, is log into this thing. And let me make sure I'm sharing the sound and I'm optimizing the video clip. All right, let's try this again.
She told me,
sister. Oh, nuts. Zoom audio device. All right, let's go back to sound flower. I don't know. It's not great. All right, well, let's just go back to that. So, all right, let me fill you in. First of all, do you guys know who this is? Her name is Maya Angelou. Maya Angelou. I saw a head nod. What's your name?
Brandon.
Who is Maya Angelou, Brandon? Famous author, famous poet. She passed away a few years ago. But yeah, very celebrated. I think she died in 2014. So here she is reflecting on kind of love that people have given to her and people that she have loved, very specifically people in her family. So she, how to put this? She had a traumatic event. You can research this if you're curious about the details of the traumatic event, just because I don't want to traumatize anybody here. She had a traumatic event as a young woman. And as a result, she's really a child. As a result, she stopped talking. You know how this can happen to people sometimes? They're traumatized. They just kind of clam up and get scared. So she was going through this. And then she went to live with her grandmother. Her grandmother took care of her. And as a result, she kind of opened up. So this particular clip is called Love Liberates, which is really just kind of a fascinating way to phrase it. Okay, so let me try one more sound thing, because the sound is really kind of an important part of sharing this. All right, I'm just going to do the internal speakers, and hopefully this will solve the problem. Unless, were we using Zoom audio device? Did that work?
I am in Tel Aviv.
All right.
I've taught in
Italy. All right, so she talks about the different places that she's taught. If you didn't quite catch that whole story, that's okay. The really key line here, she says at the end, which it actually kind of splits into another clip, but it's a really powerful line at the end here. She's thinking about her grandmother, everything she did for her.
So I am grateful to have been loved and to be loved now and to be able to love. because that liberates. Love liberates. It doesn't just hold. That's ego. Love liberates.
That was the infectious line I could not get out of my head. Love liberates. And I had to share with you all. She also continues in a kind of like a part two to this clip. I don't know why I split into two parts. So I'm going to pause this for a second. Maybe
I went out to San Francisco.
Maybe you guys are familiar with this, but it's very common to think about, especially when it comes to family, like, you know, mom and dad treated me bad, and so that's why I'm all messed up right now. Or they, you know, they broke up when I was little, and so I have abandonment issues. Or, you know, for whatever reason, I was mistreated, right? And because of the traumas I experienced as a child, I have problems now. Have you heard of this way of thinking before? I don't mean to belittle it. I think it's a very common way to think. And in fact, there's a lot of truth to it, right? And a lot of therapy is kind of going through the traumas of our past and working through them. This is a woman, as I've already told you, who has gone through many traumas, right? Incredible trauma that I don't wish upon my worst enemies. And she, specifically her mother abandoned her, right? Her mother was very, let's say, neglectful, right? Her mother neglected her in a very unfortunate way. And you can read about this. She wrote, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, and it's basically autobiography of this traumatic time. And she's reflecting on her mother in this part, right? The first part was her grandmother. This part is her mother. And her mother is dying, and she's thinking about her mother. So she kind of continues this idea of a liberatory love, right? This idea that love liberates. So we can finish off the Maya Angelou part here.
That's good. And the doctor said she had three weeks to live. I asked her, would you come to North Carolina? She said, yes. She had emphysema and lung cancer. I brought her to my home. She lived for a year and a half. And when she was finally, in extremis, she was on oxygen and fighting cancer for her life. And I remembered her liberating me. And I said, I hope I'll be able to liberate her. She deserved that from me. She deserved a great daughter, and she got one. So in her last days, I said, now, I understand that some people need permission to go. As I understand it, you may have done what God put you here to do. You were a great worker. You must have been a great lover, because a lot of men, and if I'm not wrong, maybe a couple of women, risked their lives to love you. You were a piss-poor mother of small children, but you were a great, great mother of young adults. And if you need permission to go, I liberate you. I went back to my house, and something said, go back. I was in my pajamas. I jumped in my car and ran, and the nurse said, she's just gone. You see, love liberates. It doesn't bind. Love says, I love you. I love you if you're in China. I love you if you're cross town. I love you if you're in Harlem. I love you. I would like to be near you. I'd like to have your arms around me. I'd like to hear your voice in my ear. But that's not possible now. So I love you. Go.
Okay. Maya Angelou, ladies and gentlemen. Again, I found this very inspiring. I don't know if you did, but I hope you did. And I think it fits in nicely with this conversation, because she's using the word love in kind of an innovative and powerful way, right? I mean, does her way of talking about love fit into this list, or do we have to make a new category? What do you guys think? Say it again. Mm-hmm. Chat, do we need a new category? Chat's very quiet today. Yeah, would you say it is divine love? Familial love? It's definitely directed toward her family, right? So I totally agree with Kevin in that regard. She's talking about her mother, she's talking about her grandmother. And so for sure, I think that's appropriate here. Does the way she talked about love apply to erotic love? This idea love liberates, love does not bind. Can we apply that to erotic love? Can we make sense of that? A boyfriend or girlfriend, can you say, I liberate you, right? She was talking about her mother leaving, right? Her mother dying. But romantic partners leave us, don't they? Can we say, can we liberate our romantic partners? You guys ever done that before? It's sort of a hard question. She pointed at it, right? She talked about somebody kind of flying away, being far away. I don't know if you've ever been in a long distance relationship. It's challenging, I have been. And so there's a certain amount of liberation that's required, right? I'm going to let you go do your thing. I'm not going to bind you and try to keep you close to me because that is what I want, right? It's really, again, I think it's a very powerful message. This idea that love liberates, it does not bind. And I think it's very clearly stated. I as we're discussing, I don't know if it neatly fits in any of these. Maybe we need its own category. I would argue it's very related to this one, though. This idea of divine love. Would you agree with me on that regard? How is it divine? How is it transcendent in some way? And if I didn't give you this background, we wouldn't even know that there was trauma. She had this one little line like, you are a piss poor mother of small children, right? Did you guys catch that one little line? But it was almost like playful. She's like, it's not a big deal that you abandoned us, right? Sorry, tell me your name. Kristen. All right, so I think I've got everybody's name. I'll probably forget them, but I've heard all your names. All right, so Kristen. Yeah, so I totally agree with Kristen, right? There's almost like a grace in the way that she deals with what can be very difficult. Again, maybe you guys come from happy families, and you know, I hope that you do, but familial love is rarely easy. Maybe never is too strong a word, but it's very rarely easy, right? A lot of kind of unfortunate things come along with familial love at the same time. And especially this idea of binding, right? I can give you an example. I have a younger brother who is about your guys' age, maybe a little bit older than you. He left my parents' home for like the first time. You know, even when he was in college, he still lived with my parents. He was like, it's cheaper, but I could tell it's because he just liked my mom feeding him and taking care of him and that sort of thing, right? Say it again. Yes, exactly. And I can relate. Maybe you guys can relate. My first week of college, I was very homesick, right? I didn't want to leave home. He left for like a semester and he went right back. He's like, you know, the food's better. I can do my laundry more conveniently. And I was like, yeah, whatever. All right. And so, you know, I felt like it was a little bit almost like stunting or something, right? But he did finally leave. And I'm sure it broke my mom's heart. I'm sure it did, right? And at the same time, this language of liberation, if my mom were Maya Angelou, she'd say, go fly and be free, you know, go out into the world and flourish. I don't judge my mother, right? As you can probably tell, she's a very loving woman. But even this very loving woman has a little bit of binding to it, right? You can love somebody very much, but still kind of want to hold on to them. Or, you know, the opposite can also happen. You can feel somebody is holding on to you and feel a little suffocated. Have you ever had either of those experiences before? I'm going to guess probably. You don't have to share. What the hell is this? All right, go away. And so in any case, I think Maya Angelou, she's stating it very nicely, very clearly. There is a way to navigate this somewhat tricky ocean. She talks about God a lot. And I think that allows her to find that grace, to find that forgiveness perhaps, right? For anybody who has mistreated her or done her harm in any way. Okay, maybe that's enough. Any other thoughts on this? I think we've got about a half hour. So let's see what happens with this love song. We heard this last time, but we didn't really dig into it, so I want to dig into it more. We also have Tevye the Dairyman. We might not get to it. If we do get to it, that'll be fine. We can just spend a few minutes on it, and then we'll finish with it next time. I've been talking a lot. Now I want to turn things over to you. I've given you this Endless Love song. I'll play a little bit for you. We don't have to listen to it, the whole thing. Remember this?
There's only you in my life, the only thing that's right. My first love, you're every breath that I take, you're every step I make.
Okay. Oh, that was even turned down here. Okay. So we've got this love song. I've even written the lyrics down, which I'm going to send to you all in the chat. And so what I want you guys to do, 10 out of 10, that's what I'm saying. All right. I'm glad I got some support. Thank you, Zamo. So here are the lyrics. As you can see, there are different lines. They sing separately at the beginning. It's he and a she. This might be sort of familiar. Same thing's happening in the Song of Songs, right? Am I right? So there's sort of a parallel there. And then they start singing together. Most of the song, they sing together. So what I want you to do, I'm going to break you up into groups, and I want you to sort of try this reading response activity, which is, first of all, you just read the love song and think, all right, what is this love song about? This one's pretty simple. Just two people who love each other singing about how they love each other. Just like the Song of Songs, right? Two people who love each other singing about how they love each other. And now I want you to take another step and bring in that sort of transcendent aspect. The simplest way is to say God, right? So we are one of the characters. God is another character. We're singing to each other. And then what happens, right? How do you do that? How do you explain that? How does that transform the song? So that's the exercise I'm asking you to do. Are you guys clear on this? Does anybody have any questions about what I'm asking you to do? So please open up this Google Doc. It's got the lyrics. When I put you into breakout rooms, the chat I think will disappear, or you get like a new chat. So please open it up now. I'm gonna pause the recorder. Hello, everybody. So how were your conversations? Pretty good. 135 to 250. All right, so yeah, we got 12 minutes. Maybe you guys are like typing to each other. This is my second semester doing the hybrid teaching, and I've found that some students like to talk and some students like to type. And if you prefer to type, that's okay. I'm not gonna judge you if I don't hear your voice. So do whatever feels comfortable, but do communicate with each other, right? Because this is your chance to talk and ask questions and, you know, learn some things and have some fun with your classmates. So I hope that you take advantage of it. Any reflections from any of the groups? We had some nice conversations in my group, but I'd like to hear from other groups. Anybody else? Chat, anybody in the chat wanna give me a summary of the highlights of your conversation? No summaries, no highlights? Nothing? You guys just want to hear the highlights from my conversation? Okay, why don't we do this together then? How does that sound? Okay, so here are the lyrics. My love, there's only you in my life. So what is this song about? If I just gave you this song, you heard Diana Ross and Lionel Richie singing it to each other. Again, they got sort of like the classic early 80s look going on here. What would you say they're singing about? What is this song about? Another way to put it is, what is the intended meaning of this song? I'll give you all my love, baby. You're the only one for me. Yeah, absolutely. From the first line, there's only you in my life is what the man says to the woman. Then the woman says, my first love, you're every breath that I take, you're every step that I make, right? In this first love, there's like a notion that he's the only one for her. He explicitly says that she's the only one for him. There's this language of only you, right? We could call it a soulmate. I think that's what we called it in my group, right? They could be soulmates. One word that I'm gonna pull out here is monogamy, which is a little bit of a dry and not very interesting word, but what is monogamy talking about? One partner, right? It's got mono at the beginning, right? It just means one, monogamy. Now, if we interpret this as scripture now, we're making a flip here. Leo, you see where we're going with this? Hey, yeah, monotheism. You guys heard of this before? Monotheism, one God, right? So mono means one, theism, God. What would the opposite of monotheism be? What would another? Yeah, polytheism.
Polytheism.
Yes, polytheism, which means many gods, right? And so if we interpret this as scripture from a monotheistic perspective, it actually links up pretty nicely. Do you notice that? Now, are there people who have multiple partners in love? Is there a word for that? Yeah, polygamy. It's just like monogamy, but with poly. That's really hard to spell. I think I got it though. There's also polyamory. You guys heard of that? So that means multiple.
Polyamory.
Multiple lovers. Polygamy. I think the gumi part just means woman, I want to say. Maybe it doesn't mean woman. Maybe it means wife. I'm not sure. But if it's one woman with multiple husbands, it's a different word. Polyandry is that word. You don't have to know that one, though. So does that go for players? Well, you know, Zamo, that's a whole nother conversation. Here we're talking about soulmates, my friend, right? And so you don't want to, especially if we interpret this as scripture, you don't want to play with God, because then God starts playing with you. Again, it feels a little bit like a joke, but it's a similar sort of process, right? You're committing yourself to one God. We could tie it in with like the golden calf. Have you guys heard of the golden calf before? C-A-L-F. Golden calf. Calf, you know, means like a small cow, right? Basically, during the time of Moses, people were worshiping this golden calf, and it became a symbol for kind of like polytheism. It's like another God. And so if we thought about that in terms of relationships, that would be like being a player, right? And God gets pissed off when you're playing around like this. He doesn't want you worshiping a bunch of other people. He wants you worshiping only him. And so this is one reason I'm giving you this assignment, is because actually these religious values often reflect very deeply in our interpersonal values, in our relationships, in the way that we love each other. And I think it's not by accident, right? These things are very much aligned. It's not to say everywhere that is has polytheistic religions also has polygamy. I'm not trying to go out and say that. But I do think that it kind of opens the door for that in a way that wouldn't be possible with monotheistic traditions. Okay, so this could be about monotheism, right? If we wanted to interpret this as scripture. What, any other themes jump out at other people? Let's try to think of at least one more. Go ahead.
Endless love.
Endless love.
When you talk, yeah, that is related kind of eternity.
Excellent. Eternity. Yeah, I mean, it's the name of the song, so maybe we kind of overlook it. We hear this idea of loving somebody forever, but at the same time, can you love somebody forever? Is that like something that's kind of realistically possible? Are you going to live forever? You're not going to live forever, right?
Yeah, exactly. What we was talking about is that a love for a human being will end with death of that person, of the end of the lover. But the love for God will always remain, so it becomes eternity.
Yeah, wonderful. And so even within this song, we see a pretty religious expression, just as Drissa is very nicely pointing out, right? We can promise that we will love other people forever, But the fact of the matter is that this life will come to an end. It has to, right? And at the same time, we can say our love is eternal. Our love is even beyond this life, right? I love you with my soul and not just my body, right? My body might die, but my soul continues on. Maybe we'll love each other in the next life as well, right? You've heard this language before, I'm sure. And that is what is being evoked in this title, this idea of endless love. It's a very religious idea in many ways. And so it doesn't take too much of a leap to think that my love for God is also eternal, right? When I go to heaven, I'll be able to spend the rest of eternity with God. And so this idea of eternity is very much wrapped up with ideas of God too. Excellent. Okay. Maybe that's enough of that. Do you guys have any last thoughts on this song? It's a pretty simple song in a way, right? It's basically like, I love you forever. I love only you, right? I think we've torn it apart pretty nicely. You can pick any song. I think I said this in the smaller group. You can pick any love song. I want it to be a love song, but it could be any love song. It could be a breakup song. It could be a song of like unrequited love where you really love this person but can't have them. It could be a song where, what's it called? Like a torch song. Have you heard of these before? Where somebody breaks up with you, but you still hold a torch for them. So anything, any sort of expression of love that you want to explore. And if you, again, you could come from a monotheistic angle where you're talking to God. You could come from any other angle too, right? If you're more familiar with Buddhism or with some other tradition, you could be talking about enlightenment. You could be talking about a specific Hindu deity. You could be talking about the Buddha. You could be talking about any sort of thing that you want to talk about. And you could come from many different angles. The only thing I ask you to do is you've got the human, you've got the transcendent being of some kind, and then the scripture is the love song that holds them together, right? Is that pretty clear? Okay. Any last questions? Are you clear on what I'm asking you to do? Looks pretty good. I got some thumbs up. That's what I like to see. All right. Maybe we have 3 minutes. I'll just give you a very brief taste of Tevye the Dairyman. This is also about love, which is why I assigned it for today. I think I overlooked how complicated Smith is. It took a little longer for us to go through it. And part of it is because we had the snow day on Monday too. We weren't able to go into as much detail. This is also about love. It's about marriage. And one thing we can talk about on Monday, here are all the different characters. But if you, let's see. Yeah, this is what I want to talk about. What kinds of loves are depicted here too, right? And we see some of these same sorts of love. In one scene, we've got Tevye, the father, talking to Laser Wolf, who is the butcher. And they're talking about Tsetel, who is the daughter, as if she is just some sort of dependent who can be kind of passed around, right? And so that's a very clear depiction of this dependent love. But at the same time, that gets challenged in the very story, right? Tsetel says she doesn't want to do that. And so eventually the father kind of looks kindly on her. He quotes the Bible a lot. And so there's a certain type of divine love, definitely some familial love in there where he's trying to be kind of giving her what she wants, basically. And then there's the poor tailor that she loves named Model, and they talk to each other as well. So lots of different kinds of love happening in this story too. I think it's probably not gonna fit into the writing assignment for tonight, so you can just ignore this for now, but we can come back to this conversation on Monday too. So if there are no last questions, why don't we just call it a day? Any last questions? All right. So nice talking with you all. Good luck writing. If you're confused, if you feel like you got it now and then you sit down when it's time to do it, you're like, I don't know what to do. Send me an email and I will respond pretty quickly. I'm pretty good at that. So pick a fun song, have some fun with it. Again, this is your chance to be kind of creative, and I look forward to reading it, right? I get to listen to the songs that you recommend. So have a good night. Have a good weekend. I won't see you again. And then I'll see you guys on Monday.